FIFA World Cup is the biggest single sporting event in the world, happening every 4 years, with television audiences in the hundreds of millions. Africa will be sending 5 representatives to Brazil, and Nigeria's Africa's reigning champions will be ably represented. Hello, Nigeria. My name is Temi Sanukomi, and this is Hotspot Locker Room Extra. That is the only show in the world that go behind the scenes of Nigeria Super Eagles camp gists. If anybody has a tattoo in their backside, we will tell you. It's that kind of show. And of course, we'll be talking about plenty as the days roll on. But I won't be in the studio talking about all of this by myself. In the studio with me, I've got 2 great guys. First of all, some of you already listened to him on the radio. I've got Chuka Izuegbuna up here. Chuka, welcome to the show.
Yeah, Temi, it's always good to be talking sports. It's something that I always look forward to. And with the World Cup around, just around the corner, can't wait to get started.
Right, and of course, saving the big guns for last, this man certainly needs no introductions. Probably one of the best defenders Nigeria has ever had. A member of probably, arguably, Nigeria's best ever team ever. My opinion anyway. USA 94, a coach, plays his football everywhere. Started in ACB actually. Plays his football everywhere. And for a strange reason, they call him Cerezo. Coach Augustine Egbuevan, welcome to the show.
So it's always nice to be here, especially when we'll be talking about behind the scenes and not just football itself.
Right, and you usually know a lot about
exactly.
that.
Exactly, but point of correction, started with Ben Insurance Super Club.
Ben Insurance.
Otherwise, they will find you when I go back to Ben tomorrow.
And you've got a great history with that team, don't you?
Definitely.
Ben Insurance.
Definitely.
Plenty to talk about. All right, first of all, Super Eagles camp. The camp will be opening in May in London, a place Scotland. And we have to start from there. That's where everything has started. From. You've been there. You've been the player. Part of the greatest team ever this country has ever known. Was there a better team than the 94 squad?
Well, when I was growing up, I was opportunity to see people like Christian Choku. He's actually my idol. So Odegbami playing. I felt that team was actually very
the
good.
The 80 squad.
The 80 squad. And then
they never took us to the World Cup.
Yeah. Well,
they couldn't win games on the road.
It doesn't really matter. You know, why we were winning games on the road was because a lot of us were playing in Europe.
Right.
So whatever the Europeans knew, or the North Africans knew, we knew about them. So when we came back home to take on this countries, it was easy for us to win.
I still don't believe you. I think you're just being humble. All right, let's talk about this one. Opens May 26th in London, the camp. And I've been one of those. Look, at our team will be playing in Brazil. Different weather from where they'll be opening their camp. Is that a mistake?
For me, I wouldn't really say it's a mistake. Whatever condition the coach feels that will bring out his strategies out better, I think it's up to him. If he says London
right.
to precise, Europe is the place that he should camp his player, that's his decision. I wouldn't stand there, sit here and be making casting aspersions on his decision. Secondly, because we've seen him in the past, he's made correct decisions. Nobody gave him a chance. Whenever he made a decision, we always castigated that decision, and he's always come out to prove us wrong and prove himself right. So if he says London, I'll back him to do well in Brazil.
Now, unfortunately, if I ask Cerezo this question, why do they call you Cerezo?
Well,
what is Cerezo?
Yeah. You know, the famous Cerezo that played for Brazil
in
World Cup 1982.
Right.
So that same year, I played in the Under-16 tournament in Sweden, Gothia Cup to be precise.
Right.
And it was so, you know, it's one of these players that I really adored. And then I was playing like him as well, because I was playing different positions. And some of our teammates just decided to name Cerezo.
And he's stuck.
He's stuck.
Everybody loves
I'm stuck with
I
it.
I like it. Yes. I like it.
Well, yeah, just to add to what
right.
Chuka was saying, you know, it's not Keshi's call to open a camp in England. But you mind you, we're playing Scotland there.
Right.
And 2 or 3 days after that, we're off to the US.
Right.
So it's a duty call. We must play that friendly game to make sure we see how far our team is right now. It's not that we're going to spend or Nigeria is going to spend like a week or 2 there. So I don't see anything
okay, so there's nothing wrong with that one.
No, not at all.
Okay, now we're going to open the camp in the USA. You've been here. You've been a player. You've been a coach twice over. You've taken our junior teams. You've taken our senior teams. And how does it work?
Well, you know, World Cup is less than 2 months from now.
And Kesh is going through a lot, but I adopt my heart for him because he's remaining focused. He always remained focused. But the good thing here is the players are ready. They want to make their mark. Everybody's still talking about USA 94 being the best team ever. And it's our own prayer for us to see this player surpass our success. So if this team is actually ready, like what I'm envisaging, you know, I think they all will be in the camp after the last league match in their different leagues in Europe. And then that will actually put them in good team spirit. And then we'll go from there.
Okay, now if you were a coach, because if I ask you about some of Kesh's decisions, you'll probably be diplomatic.
I'll tell you like this.
You tell like it is.
Go ahead.
Right. Osazio Dembige.
Yes.
Should he or shouldn't he?
He should.
Why?
Why? Simple reason. Right now we have strikers that are really giving us, you know, hope. It's Emenike's number one, and Ideye comes from the bench. Outside these two players, there's no other central striker that can always deliver. So if Emenike and Ideye are going to be doing the job, mind you, friendly games into the World Cup proper, from now to the World Cup finals, July 14th.
Right.
Yeah. So you're looking at maybe minimum of 10, 12 games. So if Emenike alone can't do it, Emenike can go in there, rattle people when he gets tired, he's replaced, Osaze can go finish the job.
Yeah, but what about the talk about, let me go check out because I'm going to take your the coach's point of view. All the talk about destabilizing influence. Osaze destabilizes the locker room. Kesh says he doesn't like Ikechukwu Uche because he's indisciplined. Shouldn't that be a factor as well?
Yeah, personally, on this line, I would like to disagree a bit with Austin. For me, I've always been an apostle of, you don't take your best players to the World Cup or to a tournament. You take your best team.
Right.
Your best players don't necessarily mean that they will gel. For me, I think that Osaze has just been humbled because he sees this as his last hurrah. He just wants to, you know, make this his swan song. I still think he will be a destabilizing factor in the locker room. Yes, he's eating humble pie, but doesn't mean that he readily agrees with Stephen Kesh's philosophies. It doesn't mean that he thinks that Stephen Kesh is a good coach. For him, if he goes to the World Cup and plays three games and comes back home, it's all good for him. But for Nigerians, for Stephen Kesh personally, he wants to do beyond playing just three games. For him, if to go as far as the semi-final, so discipline is a very, very big factor in this team. And Coach Stephen Kesh has been able to maintain a high level of discipline, which has been his key to success. So personally, Ikechukwu Uche and Osaze should not be part of this team.
Well, all right, we have to take a quick break here. You've got somebody like Coach Austin Egbuavoen in the studio. You tend to talk too much. And of course, we've got the makings of a great show because Chuka is beginning to disagree with him. Anyway, before the friendly against Mexico, the Super Eagles had a little bit of downtime. They roamed around the streets of Atlanta. And yes, we had cameras following them. I heard the nightlife in Atlanta is pretty racy. Let's see how that went. Song with the Eagles is next. We'll be back after this.
Saying goes, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. Before the international friendly against Mexico in Atlanta, the Super Eagles took time out to visit some shopping malls in the city and pick up some choicy items. The Super Eagles players also caught the attention of fans on the streets of Atlanta who were delighted to get their autographs and a few footage snapshots. Put your flags up in the sky. Then it was time to get down to business in the training session inside the Georgia Dome in Atlanta, venue of the Nigeria-Mexico friendly. The 80,000 capacity Georgia Dome has hosted several soccer matches since 2009 that have drawn over 50,000 fans. For the Super Eagles, training inside the indoor arena, shielded from the windy cold of Atlanta, was a pleasant exercise that further gingered their aspirations for a positive result against the Mexicans. Put your flags up in the sky.
Welcome back, guys. It's Hot Sports Locker Room Extra. It's our show going behind the scenes of Nigeria Super Eagles camp gist, training, everything in between the football matches. Now, of course, that friend is come and gone. Mexico, we finished goalless. I've got Coach Austin Egwavon here. I've got Chuka Izegbunam here. And let me go with Coach first. You saw the game. It was a pretty, maybe decent goalless draw. One of the better goalless draws, we say, but it still was a goalless draw. What was, first of all, you saw the game.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, and you must have noticed a few flaws. That's why we play friendly matches, to notice the flaws.
Very
what
correct.
Did you notice, first of all?
Very correct. I think both teams were trying to cancel each other out. We've actually met four times.
Yeah.
It has all ended
square.
Square. And this last one now, it's very close to the World Cup. Unlike the previous one, sometimes 6 months before the World Cup, it's not a World Cup year and all that. And so both teams had a lot to prove, you know, and a lot of people have talked about Nigerian team for a while now in the African Champions coming to that game. Yes, we started with very, very anxious to get a goal. So we were a little bit, you know, too agitated and there was no cohesion. But after a while, we settled down a little bit because Mexicans is not a team that you can just, you know, push aside. But at the end of the day, We had two chances to go up, but we squandered those chances. Mexico also had their own chance. But I would say both keepers on that day were the best.
Oh, yeah.
You know, if not, I think we have still ended the draw, but maybe score draw.
All right, Chuka, because coach is worked with some of these players. Yeah. So you might be a bit loath to say, I think this match should have played like this. Right, you don't know them. You just report on them. Now, first of all, you think maybe some of these players were playing for their World Cup place? Could that have been brought to the anxiety that he's talked about?
I quite agree on that because if you notice, there are quite a number of new players in that team who are fighting to get into the team. So normally anxiety will set in, you know, trying to impress the coach, and it's up to the coach to try and settle them down, calm them down, to just play their game. If not, if they were,
have you coached the football team before? It's up to the coach.
It's got ideas.
It's got ideas, eh? I'm just wondering. He knows so much.
I agree with him. The truth is, if they were not good enough, he wouldn't have invited them in the first place. So he must have seen something in these players. And looking at the game proper, like you said, it was a decent game. For me, even if we had lost that game, it wouldn't have been I wouldn't have gone out to judge them based on that game.
Tell his former bosses. they never listen. They never listen. The friendly matches, you must win it.
Yes, yeah, because Nigerians love to see their team win all the time.
When did it change, though? We used to like to watch Brazilian flair.
Yes.
That is why JJ Okocha was so big. We liked the dribbles. Because frankly, Okocha was pretty wasteful in a team, in our Super Eagles team. He was pretty wasteful with the ball. But we loved him. When did it change from we like to see good football to yes. we must win football?
You know, it's a global world now. Before we didn't say beyond our nose.
Right.
But now we are so vast and we watch a whole lot of international games. And then we see, and most of our players are playing the big leagues now also. So if you measure Messi for Argentina, you measure Mikel for Nigeria. So which means we can actually match these people.
Can you mention them in the same breath? Messi and Mikel.
No,
one
player doesn't make a team. I'm just saying Messi out of the Argentina team.
Right.
So we also have the Mikel out of the Nigerian
team.
Does
it bother you that Mikel doesn't see football?
Well, it bothers me. Bothers me, but it's up to Jose Mourinho if Mikel is going to play or not. But as far as I'm concerned, Mikel has got a leadership quality, and we actually need it in our game. But like he actually said about Mexico and Nigeria, you know, it's the fourth time we played. I remember that I played against Mexico in the Confederation Cup '95,
right,
in Saudi Arabia,
it was exactly.
So Mexico is not a team you can, you know, brush aside easily. And then when we went as far as Mexico again in 2007, I was assistant to Betty Vokes.
Right.
It's still to draw.
Right.
We could have won that game that day, but, you know, Martins had a penalty and he blew it. So it's still...
Is Martins still relevant in our Super Eagles team?
I would say no now before he left the United States, when he was still in Western Europe.
But if Bright DK is playing, United States football is not exactly the best, but... Bright DK, we've seen him, scored against Italy. Yeah, if Bright can do it in America, why not Martins?
Well, probably because Martins has been around for a while.
You so know, it's about time
is,
to
no,
let.
No, this is how we look at it.
Right.
DK is new, so we want to go with DK.
Would you take Martins if you had the chance?
Even while he was in Spain, I would have come. I thought at that stage that he was already going downhill. So for me, nothing Martins can offer us right now. And
he's not asking if Martins should come back to the team.
No, I'm not asking.
Yes.
No.
Yes. He's just comparing.
I'm just comparing.
The leagues.
Yes,
because
the leagues.
DK is playing down there.
That's what I'm saying. Yes. That for Martins, yes, even while he was in Spain.
And what about DK then?
DK has shown some qualities that we don't...
Regardless of the league he's playing.
He's shown some qualities
that... goal against Catalonia, loved it.
Loved it. He's a hard worker. And that's something we need in that attack besides... And he's shown that he can score goals. If you look at Ideye, he's a hard worker too, but he's not getting...
Is that Ideye's fault, coach? He scores in Ukraine for his club.
Yeah.
He comes there, doesn't score. Is that his fault? Or is it the way he's played?
No, I wouldn't say it's his fault, you know, because out there he plays probably as a point man.
True.
And down here he plays sometimes behind the striker, as a second striker. So probably, or maybe if he's given that role to play, you know, as a point man, why not? He might just turn the thing around.
Moving on.
You know, not to disrespect DK, I think it's not because he's playing the MLS. That reduces his, you know, his quality.
Right.
You know, it's wherever you find yourself, that's where you play right now. I think he's also good enough to play in Europe.
All right, so these guys can talk our ears off. Now, before that game against Mexico, we had a chat just before the game with Obinna on Sofo. And of course, we had to talk to Elite 2P himself, Chicharito Javier Hernandez of Mexico. Only us. So stick around, we'll be back after this one.
Normally, before a big match like the Nigeria-Mexico friendly, players are upbeat about a favourable outcome. Nigeria's forward Victor Obinna-Nsofo, who stars as the second striker for AC Chievo Verona of Italy, on loan from Lokomotiv Moscow, and Manchester United hitman Javier Hernandez, popularly known as Chicharito, are our guests on the chat room. First, let's start with Nsofo, who has so far made 6 appearances this year for Chievo. We asked Victor how he feels about the friendly game against Mexico.
It's a massive game. It's one of those games that are very important for the team, for the build-up towards the World Cup, you know, to put the team in shape, to prepare the team in a good condition, you know, towards the World Cup.
We also asked Victor about the team spirit in the camp.
Well, the atmosphere has always been very welcoming. I could remember when I first came to the national team, the big boys then, Kanu Nwankwo, Okocha, you know, they were very, very, you know, supportive. They welcomed us like, you know, like a brother, junior brother. So it's the same things, the same atmosphere. And, you know, the new faces that are here, you know, they just came in and, you know, they're fitting very well at the moment. And, you know, the same spirit, you know, the support that all the older players, you know, have shown to them. And I believe they're going to, you know, they're going to do the best for the country.
Now let's swing a pendulum to the camp of the Mexicans, who also had their training sessions at the Georgia Dome. We picked out one man, Javier Chicharito Hernandez, who has turned out to be Mexico's ever reliable point man, and this is what he has to say about the game with Nigeria.
No, I think it's going to be the same match, you know, very hard game. That game we drew and it was a very difficult game, you know, because they sent off one player, but yeah, Nigeria's a very good national team, and because it's going to be this game, they bring all their best players, and I think it's going to be a very good match.
Chicharito was, however, cautious in his response to Mexico's chances at Brazil 2014.
No, it's going to be tough, but right now I want to be very respectful because of that. No, the World Cup is a little bit far from me now. I'm just thinking about Nigeria.
Welcome back, guys. Hot Sports Locker Room Extra, the only show on planet Earth that goes behind the scenes of Nigeria Super Eagles, right, and their lifestyles, of course. Plenty of you usually like to know. Probably ask Cyrus when we come back, Coach Egwuegbunam, about his lifestyle. But plenty of you like to know, how does Mikel roll? What does they do? Well, yes, we know all of these things. So it's time for you all to know. So Super Eagles lifestyle, stick around. Cyrus and Chuka will be back after this.
For Super Eagles stars, creating leisure time to relax with family members is a memorable experience. On this Super Eagles stars lifestyle story, we beam a searchlight on Dan the Bull Amokachi's twins. It's a big revelation on the Super Eagles assistant coach.
I'm Kalim Amokachi, the son of Daniel Amokachi, the assistant coach of Nigerian national team.
And you?
I'm Nazim Amokachi, same thing, son of Daniel Amokachi, the assistant coach of the Nigerian national team.
You boys definitely have a strong resemblance of your fathers. Have you been told that before?
A lot of times. It's true. We do look like our dad, especially me. I kind of have his physique, so, yeah.
Do you both play football?
Yeah. We play for Sharks St. Mary's Academy in Minnesota.
You also both have your father's character. You're straight to the point and brusque, would you say?
Yeah, true. You can say we got that from our dad, so, yeah.
So, tell us about your upbringing. Where were you guys born?
Well, we were born in Liverpool, in England. And at the time, my dad was playing for Everton, so we stayed there for a couple of years, I think. And then we moved to Turkey, where my dad went to Besiktas in Istanbul. Yeah, and then after that, we went back to Nigeria, and we grew up there, so. So we were like 13, and then we moved back to Liverpool for school. Yeah.
So, out of the two of you, who's the more? Because you're twins, obviously. One obviously is gonna have a different character compared to the other. Who's the more outgoing and who's the introvert?
It depends. Sometimes we switch. Sometimes I'm more outgoing. Sometimes he is. So it depends.
What position do you guys play?
I play a left wing.
And you?
I'm a striker.
Are there some things that you take from your father's game that you've seen that you emulate on the field as well?
Yeah, probably his strength and how he drives forward with the ball. That's probably it.
And you?
Yeah, I'll probably say the same thing, but I won't say I'm quite as physical as my dad. But yeah, probably driving forward. Yeah.
Not physical yet, right?
Not yet.
So, growing up as the son of the legendary Daniel Amokachi, did you guys ever see him play? Obviously, you were probably too young at Liverpool, but did you see him? Did you get to see him play in Istanbul when he was at Besiktas?
I don't think so, because still then we were pretty young. So, But we have seen like cassettes and videos of him on YouTube, so we know what he's about.
What are some of the things that you like about your father's game when he played club football and also for the national team?
Well, he sort of always tried to take the team like on his shoulders, try and motivate the players and push forward every time.
Growing up as the son of Amokachi, obviously you've seen him coach in Nigeria. When he is at your own games, is he trying to coach at all, or does he coach before the game?
Well, a bit of both. Sometimes he tries to give us out some pointers and stuff, so yeah, he does a bit of both.
You're playing at the academy now here in Minnesota. Is the plan to go to school in the United States, or the plan is to play football full time?
Well, it always depends. Like, I would love to like get a professional contract and play, but at the same time, if it doesn't come, then we'll have to go to college and keep playing there till we get a chance.
So, for you, what you guys came down from Minnesota to see your father. What are you expecting to see today? Obviously, he's going to be on the sidelines with the team. Are you going to be watching him more or watching the game? What are you going to be doing?
To be honest, I'll be watching the game because, as well as my dad's the assistant coach, we're also supporters of the national team. And we're hoping that Nigeria could come up with a win. So.
Back in Nigeria, were you guys known as Daniel Amokachi's kids, or people didn't really know who you were in Nigeria?
Yeah, especially where we stayed, everyone knew us. Like every time we'd walk on the streets, and people would always be staring at us and looking and saying to one another, there's Amokachi's kids. So, yeah, we're well known around our area.
Were you used to that after a while? Is that something that you got used to and it just became second parcel?
Yeah, we just started getting used to it. Now it's normal.
Your father told us yesterday that, you know, he's not only a physical guy, but he likes to be in the gym and work out. Is that something that you guys like to do as well?
Yeah, we try to emulate that because it helps with our game. So, yeah, once in a while we like going to the gym, pushing ourselves to try and get what we need to succeed.
What's your favorite football team?
Real Madrid.
And you?
Well, it's going to sound a bit dodgy, but Manchester United.
Your father played at Everton.
Everyone asks me that, why am I not an Everton supporter, but it's not till a while ago that I started enjoying their football, but like I've always loved Manchester United and how they played, so yeah.
Obviously being around your father, you'd have met a lot of other legends like him that played for Nigeria. Who are some of the guys you've seen in the past that you really, you know, enjoyed their presence and just enjoyed their character?
Well, we've seen Okocha, Kanu, Yakubu, but I'll say the best is Okocha because he was one of the best Nigerian soccer players. So, yeah, same JJ Okocha. We went to his house one time in Lagos, and very lively guy. Always tries to keep us at home. So yeah.
So is he your favorite player over your dad?
No. I say my favorite player is Cristiano Ronaldo. I admire him a lot.
And you?
I'll say my dad, just to keep it safe.
And then, of course, the big one. Let's see what head coach Stephen Keshi, the big boss himself, has to offer from the home front.
Tell us your name.
Stephen Keshi.
Stephen Keshi. We already know Stephen Keshi. He is the former Nigerian international and the current coach of the Super Eagles. How is he related to you?
It's my father. It's my father, Stephen Keshi.
We know him as a legend, as coach. How do you know him as growing up as a kid?
I know him as my father. You know, you guys get to see this stuff on TV, but I just know him from my personal experience. He's just been a father to me, you know. I know about his accolades and everything, but in my eyes, he's just pop. So that's what it is. Great mentor to me, been a great father. He's always there for me if I need advice. He's always there. So that's who he is, and he's a father, you know.
How do you refer to him? You call him coach?
I call him Coach and he calls me Mr. Keshi. So that's how we do it. Every time he calls, Coach, Mr. Keshi, everything good? Yep. Talk to you later. So it's good.
Where were you born?
I was born in Brussels, Belgium.
How long were you in Belgium, and when did you move to the United States?
I was in Belgium for a couple years, and then I moved to France, Paris, and then back to Belgium before I moved to the United States. And then there was a time when he was playing in Malaysia, so we got to stay in Malaysia for a few months as well. But I got settled in into the States in like the 96, 97.
Did you get to move around a lot as a kid? Because football players move around, so it means their family moves around with them too.
They did, but one thing they did a great job is making sure that we grew up with the same people, that we were able to be comfortable at home. So we didn't do too much moving around. He did all the moving around, really. I stayed in the Bay Area since recently. Now I moved to Atlanta. I went to Atlanta for school. Graduated from Morehouse College a couple years ago, so I'm still here in Atlanta. I decided to live here. But before then, they made it to where we grew up in the Bay Area, grew up in the same, around the same area. So that was definitely good for us.
Give Nigerians a perspective and people outside of the United States how significant a college like Morehouse is in terms of the history behind the school.
The history of Morehouse College runs deep. It's the only black all-male school in the United States. Always often ranked in the top three in HBCUs, historically black colleges, for you who don't know what HBCUs are. The history is rich, man. Martin Luther King Jr. went to Morehouse College, a whole bunch of people went to Morehouse College. It's such a great school, such a great institution. It really brings out the individual person out of you. So you get to Morehouse College, it's not all about the curriculum, it's also about building the network. How good are you speaking with people? How good are you strengthening your network? They teach you all those things, So Morehouse is a great school, man. I'm happy I was on there.
Let's come back to your father a little bit. You grew up with a legend, someone that people consider as a legend. Was he always there when you, did you play soccer as a kid? And was he always there when you played?
I played soccer as a kid. When I started playing soccer, it was late first because, he was still, well into the football. So he was always abroad. But I started playing soccer under 12s. And I played all the way through high school. I played a year of college, football and soccer. So I played American football growing up as well. But yeah, he was there. He was always there. In the beginning parts of the career when he was at home, he used to always take me and my sister out to play. My sister was an astounding soccer player, man. She played sweeper for Deer Valley High School, honorable mention, all those things. She tore her ACL her senior year. So that it didn't work out after that, but she was an outstanding footballer, man. Sophie Keshi, yeah.
So Sophie got the daddy genes.
Sophie got the daddy genes. I'm athletic now. I could get on the pitch right now and play with anybody, but I more so fell into like an entrepreneurship type thing. Like growing up, even when I was in middle school, I was a kid. I was on campus selling candy and stuff like that. I've always been a businessman. So soccer wasn't per se something I wanted to do professionally, but I did it because, I was good at it. My dad played it, so, I played it until I couldn't play it no more, really. Or lost the passion to play or whatever. But I love the game, though. I love the game.
What was he like whenever you played? Was he one of those fathers who would be coaching on the sidelines, telling you what to do and passing instructions, even though he wasn't your coach?
He's more so likes to kind of stand back and let the coach do his thing. I'm sure it's because he understands coaching and how it's your voice out there. But he would do the coaching before and after. On the pitch, he let us play. But it was good, man. My first couple years of soccer, my first year, I think I scored 24 goals. And then my under 13 year, I scored like 19. So I was doing good in the beginning. It was fun. It was fun, man. My dad was coaching us and training us through football.
Transition to, obviously, you moved to Atlanta and you said you're an entrepreneur. You have a shirt on that looks pretty amazing. What club jersey is that?
It's a Hootie FC. I started this lifestyle brand that we're releasing this summer called Hootie Rules. Basically, we're promoting entrepreneurship. We're promoting creativity. We're promoting ingenuity. So we're making a few items through special event planning and through Kickstarters and raising funds, we're going to be campaigning throughout the year and raising money for entrepreneurs out there. So basically, instead of saying, here, donate to us, this is what we're doing, we're providing them with clothing and merchandising. So 33% of what we're making is going into this fund at the end of the year that we're going to present with somebody. So throughout the year, we got a three-stage interview process. We're going to be doing a pitch deck online. We're going to do a social media contest and a Skype interview. And at the end of the year, we're just going to award the contestants who win with a substantial amount of money to start their endeavor. And we're going to be following the people who we award money to year by year to check their progression. We're just trying to make like a domino effect. We know entrepreneurship is increasing for a good reason. We feel like entrepreneurship is the only way to combat capitalism in a sense. It's like a trading, it's like a trade and barter system like we had back in the days, except it's ingenuity and creativity. So if we build something to where we all have something that we could give, we all have a business, we could hire people, we could create financial stability for ourselves, things like that. So that's what we're promoting through the brand. The brand is called Hoodoo Rules. The mascot is this blowfish. And that's what it is. This is the jersey, one of the jerseys, the hat that I'm wearing right here. So look out for it, man. It's coming out.
Growing up in California, what was life like for you? You said your father wasn't around, but you were established in California. What was life like for you there?
Growing up in California was good. I live with my three sisters and my little brother. I have a little brother that's he's actually a dance major. Great contemporary dancer, man. He's been performing and doing that for a few years now. My three older sisters, I grew up with all them, so I mean, I don't know what to say. It was comfortable, man. It was comfortable. We all had different things we were doing, so interaction was good. They always kept us real close and stuff like that, but we were all doing so many different things, but we found a way to come together. Growing up, I played soccer. My little brother played soccer for a little bit, and then my sister played soccer, my older sister Sophie. I probably should run down the name of my siblings. My older sister is Jennifer Keshi, and Stephanie Keshi, and Sophie Keshi, and then you have my little brother, who's also Stephen Keshi. Is that too much? I guess he loved the name.
All right, Nigeria, welcome back to Hot Sports Locker Room Extra with me, Timmy Sanokomi. I've got Austin Egwuabone here and Chuka Ezebuna. And we've just seen the Amokachi twins and Stephen Keshi's third son. First of all, I still remember very clearly when Amokachi's wife gave birth to the twins. It was celebrated. It was huge. And now look at them. They're all big. And school in America, graduated from the Everton Academy. This is Keshi's third son. Todd, I mean, come on. Now, if I see the boy on the road, I tell him, Miguel, I'll greet him. I go greet him.
Congratulations to Keshi.
Right.
when I was growing up also, or just before, when I left NMPC for Warri, came back to Benin Insurance. And I knew Keshi back then. A very disciplined human being. You know, I think he got married even before 21. And to a lady that, you know, came from, you know, high profile background. So, and that she has been seriously instrumental to Keshi's success.
Because you married at 21.
Right.
He married earlier. Was that the norm at that time for your set of footballers? We're making some money. What are we waiting for? Was that the norm? Let's get married.
Well, not really. When you find a hat rub that, you know, things goes well and both families agree because you don't play any hide and seek game then. So, and you want to be focused on this job because, mind you, we also went to Europe early. True. And when you're in Europe, there's no time to, excuse my language, to mess around. So if you have a girlfriend, it's purely your girlfriend.
Right.
They don't see you with two persons. Otherwise, the management of clubs start thinking twice, you know, and you'll be
that's how it was then.
Yeah, they can easily offload. It's still the same now because you can't be indisciplined when you're playing for Chelsea.
True.
Yeah. So if you know you with Maria or Rose or Bimbola, it has to be that person.
No, but that it must have changed because I won't name names. Force me, I can name the name. I saw a Nigerian footballer.
Yes.
Before a match in Lagos, was driving a beautiful Range Rover Sport.
Where is he playing?
Where is the footballer playing? Yeah. He was playing in England at the time.
Okay.
and I saw him with two or three girls in the car before a match.
Maybe he gave them a ride or something.
Yeah, right. Doors open, music, drinks. No, having a good time.
I don't think so.
If you force me, I can tell you the name.
I don't think. No, you don't have relations.
Yes.
He's
in town. They want to get some money from Big Brother and stuff like that.
Okay. Okay. You were pretty focused in your time. Keshi, we've seen, was pretty focused in his time. Amokachi, we've seen, because he's got two grown kids. How many kids do you have?
I have three.
Three of them.
Yeah.
And the youngest should be what? Maybe 15, 16?
No. I just had six. It only turned six in December.
So all the goals you didn't score as a defender, you're scoring now.
Exactly.
Oh, fantastic! We love it. Okay, we like it. But here's the thing: you've got fantastic footballers for Nigeria. You had a great, good club career, like such as yourself. But your kids are not playing football. You guys don't actively push them to play football.
No, see, one thing I've come to realize is education is very, very important. You know, nobody's stopping any of his kids not to do anything. Daniel's kids are playing right now.
They're in school now.
They're in school.
Like we just saw.
Yeah, I'm in school because I am very close to Daniel. So I know, you know, what he has invested in those kids' education. But he's not stopping them from playing.
Right.
But he also played for Everton Academy. So right. They are going to continue to play, if possible, if they really actually have the talent. You know, my first daughter was playing basketball because my wife played basketball.
Right.
You know, and like I said, my third kid is only 6 years old. I would try. First of all, after education, definitely has to take part in sports. But
would
I
would you push him to play football?
I would try.
You'll try?
I would try.
Right.
So we can look forward to another series of verse.
Possible.
Chuka, you do radio. Nobody wants to know your lifestyle, but I'll ask you anyway. What do you do before and after a show? Do you normally see these footballers in their lives and say to yourself, my goodness, I wish I could do this?
Yes, when I was a kid, I was like that. I actually, like all our peers, they would say, I actually tried to play football until the proverbial injury cut short.
Yeah, that right. I can see that you tried to play football. You look like a footballer.
But truthfully, right. Every kid then wanted to play football, you know. You get back from school, you pick up the ball, you run to the field, you play. But as you grow older and the influence of your parents on you, you begin to, you know, make decisions. Do I go on? Do I stop? And along the line, your parents' decisions tend to take the upper hand.
Well, nobody really wants to know what Chuka does. He's not a footballer. We don't want to know his lifestyle. But we've got Coach Egwavoni here. You're a player, you're a coach. There's all of these arguments about wives and girlfriends of our footballers, Super Eagles. Should they take their wives and girlfriends to Brazil? Do you think they should take their wives and girlfriends to Brazil?
Well, I'll give my opinion. And I want to also hear from Chuka.
Right.
So if we're going to agree. But it depends. Because when we went to the USA 94 World Cup, we took our wives. And the ones that had fiancés also took their fiancés, but no girlfriends.
What if it's a girlfriend that's not yet a fiancé, but you guys have been, you know, together for quite a while?
I won't allow that. But again, when you go into research, there was one book I read on this Brazilian coach. The wives of the players were in 2006 World Cup. Yes, I think I remember. Psychologically, it helps. But the wives and the fiancés don't stay in the same hotel with the players. So if I'm Eagles coach today, I would say yes. But for the fact that they stay in different hotels, yes.
So when would you normally allow them to interact?
A day after the game.
After every game? A day after every game?
After every game.
But not before a game?
No.
Right. Okay, Chuka, what do you think? Should wives and girlfriends go to Brazil?
Believe me, it's Brazil.
That Brazilian head.
I completely and totally vote for wives and girlfriends go to Brazil. Any other country I might be in between, but it's Brazil, my brother. There's too much temptation.
Won't they be distracted with wives and girlfriends?
No, they won't. Just to add to what Chuka said, you know, the security is very, very tight. You know, there is no way if you're not FIFA, you know, if you don't have the accreditation, you can't come into a hotel. If you are part of a Nigerian team or the Japanese team or the Iranian team, you leave your accreditation card somewhere. You won't even be allowed to go into a hotel, not talk of a stadium.
Austin, let me take you up here.
You've seen things happen.
I've seen things happen. I've been to international tournaments outside this country, and I have seen Super Eagles players like Timson. Let me not mention names. If these players want to get females into their room,
they will get.
They will.
See, look at Coach's smile. He's remembering his time. I can bet you're remembering your time. I'm not saying he did anything, but I can bet you're remembering your time. You must have seen players who will say, he has snuck somebody in.
No, I'm not doubting that. But if the wives and girlfriends are in there, so my question to Chuka now is, are they going to be accommodated?
Right. Now that's a good question, because here's the thing. Yeah. A lot of the hotels might be taken up.
Yes, they can be put outside the hotel.
Yeah.
That's not even what I'm talking about. I've seen after games at night where somehow they just manage to organize it.
They're young men. Your wife and your fiance
is somewhere in another hotel close by, and you decide to take somebody else in your room, then...
But you're a young man. Young men, by their nature,
are
senseless.
Because it's Brazil.
Yeah,
it's Brazil.
Okay. And for the love of God, this tournament is 3 weeks. They can abstain for 3 weeks.
Man. All right, guys. Hot Sports Locker Room Extra. We cannot go without talking this segment. We call it Talking Turf.
You know what? Before any of these players started playing, I have money. I have been in the game before they came. And I don't think any of them can give me enough money that will satisfy my hunger. Ike Uche was with me in Nations Cup. Inside me, I said I will not speak about Ike Uche's affair anymore. But because of this you brought up, I want to talk. In the past, probably they've been doing it, some coaches have been doing it, but there's one coach sitting right here.
One.
Steven Okechukwu Keshi. See you all. You can't bribe me. You cannot give me anything to entice me. I have seen a lot of people come around with monies. Please bring my pillar in. I didn't come to Nigeria for money. If I want to go for money, a small country like Equatorial Guinea pay me 4 times than what Nigeria is paying.
Coach Steven Keshi says, no player can bribe me. Let me go with the coaching here. We know it happens. It's not just here. So let's not make it look like it's a Nigerian thing. It's almost everywhere there's football played. You have players who want to be in the team who will try to induce the coach or the handlers with whatever. But Keshi saying nobody can bribe me.
In Africa?
In Africa.
I don't know about that. It's strange to me. But I think sometimes our journalists are going overboard, you know, by asking such direct questions. Probably, you know, if things like that has been happening to past coaches, that, you know, they will have, you know, that's an alibi to now say, okay, we'll have to ask such a direct question. And I think that question came when Uche was dropped, and then people started, you know, raising eyebrows and started asking questions. And then Keshi came out and said, no player can bribe me. And we should respect him and accept that. I don't think any player...
Has anybody tried to bribe you before?
No.
Did you ever try to bribe anybody?
No way.
Right, you were too good to bribe.
No way.
Come on, you were first on the list.
I tell you something. 2003, when I was under-17s coach in Abeokuta, you know, under-17, you have thousands of players.
Right.
And we were in the stadium, and somebody called me and said, listen, I have a boy who can play football. So, okay, let him bring him in. You can't shut the door on the 17 players. You never know when you find another JJ or another Mikel. So the boy came and he was holding a brown envelope. And I said, well, what's in there? He said, no, my uncle said I should give it to you. He said, no, open it, let me see. People were there. He said, no, I said, open it. Then he opened it. It was, I don't know, 500 naira notes in it. I said, okay, you know what?
Was fat.
Yeah. I said, you won't even train.
You told him he won't train?
Yeah, he won't even train anymore. So take your envelope and go back to Lagos. And the boy, he went back to Lagos. The uncle called me and said, listen, you can do that with other persons, but not with me. I didn't even allow the boy to train again.
Because you're not hungry. They've been...
No, you have to...
Because you're like me. You're a journalist.
I don't think so.
I don't want to agree that it's about hunger. I would tend to believe it's about principles. Yes, we've heard coaches, we've heard stories of coaches, especially when you see players in a team and you begin to wonder how that player got into that team. And you know, such stories coming, or when player doesn't, a player that you expect to make a team is not there. Of course, such stories come out. It happened with Stephen Keshi when he was in Togo, when he had that fallout. But for me, it's all about principles. If you're a focused coach, if you're a coach that wants to succeed, then you will agree that nobody will be able to bribe you. And for me, I think Stephen Keshi is somebody who wants to succeed. He's focused. And if you look at the kind of players he's even picking, it should be enough to tell you that, this man can't be bribed.
But to be fair to national team coaches, you hear these stories not about national team coaches. It's usually the amateur level, and that's where you usually hear these stories. Because like what happens if that was even a national team, you get maybe local clubs where the parents or the uncles that really want them to go play.
Yes,
that's where it happens.
We cannot deny that it happens.
And it's not just a Nigerian thing, because people listening or watching will say, ah, this Nigeria again. It's almost a global thing.
Yes, it's almost a global thing. That's why you have sports betting, match fixing and all that. But we can't deny that it doesn't happen. But if Keshi says that no one can bribe him,
no one can bribe him,
let's take him by his word until we see it happen.
All right. So, Sarazo, Coach Augustine Kwebon, I cannot stop thanking you. Loved you when you played football. I still can't forgive you for giving Badjo that penalty in 94, but I'll let it go. I'll let it go. Was that ball to hand?
No. What was it? Wasn't ball to hand. Well, I'll say they played on my intelligence. I can explain it.
You put your hand out.
No, it was not ball to hand. Right. You know, these guys were so experienced. And, you know, when Roberto Baggio actually chips that ball over me, I had Chidiwano behind me who was supposed to tell me, leave the ball for me.
Exactly.
Go and take that tip and play. You see? But he didn't say nothing. And Ben Arrivo caught across my face and he stood.
Ah.
So because I was keeping eye contact with the ball, I bumped into Ben Arrivo and he went down. And the referee was quick to take it.
And of course, some of that referee
was waiting for it.
Right. And what happened to you after the game? Did you just cry in your hotel room?
I felt bad. You see, that's why this present Super Eagles, I have faith in them. But I'm not looking at semifinals, to be honest.
Yeah, to be honest.
Quarterfinals, right. You know, they've done well.
Knockout.
Let us dream.
Yeah.
Don't bust out.
What I'm trying to say is the 1994 squad, you know, we never, you know, thought we'll go beyond where we got to.
Right.
It was after the game we started realizing, hey, why not? We could have gone further. Same thing happened to England in 1990, you know, when they lost to Cameroon.
Right.
When they lost to England on penalties. They were still jubilating and clapping their hands, applauding people. But they actually had the potential to go further.
Right.
So this present team, everybody's playing a big team, although they're not getting regular playing time. I think, you know, at the back of their mind, they're looking at the final prize. They're looking at the World Cup. It's behind their mind that they can win that World Cup. So that's one thing, you know, they have in mind, they have going for them.
That's our show, guys. Hot Sports Locker Room Extra. It's the only show that goes behind the scenes. Super Ego camps and everything in between. I had the fantastic Austin Egbuabun here and can't wait. We'll get him again. Don't worry about it. Of course, Chuka Ezebuna was here as well. Chuka does a great radio show. My name is Mr. Nokomi, guys. Good night.